Welcome to this workshop. Happy Friday. Happy summer. It's a new fiscal year here at UC Berkeley. So, and look at this view. Wow. So what a great time to be here, and I am thrilled to be here. My name is Lisa Rykert, and I am a life and career coach. I have my own business, Kula Coaching, and I used to work at UC Berkeley. So it's a real thrill and an honor to be back in this capacity in my current dream job. And it's just, it's really neat. I was at one point sitting in your seat. Well, maybe not up here with this great view at the time. This new stadium didn't exist. But I worked at UC Berkeley for 7 years, and it was a really great experience. And I'm going to share with you, you know, some of the things that I learned along the way, you know, that I wish I had known then with my job search, and, you know, that I now work with lots of clients and groups to help them in their job search. And we're going to talk about these career strategies to help you as you're thinking about what your next steps are. So let me just ask you, how many attended the conference, the NOW conference last year? Okay, and did anybody attend this workshop last year? That is returning again. Okay, great, so it's all new information, and hopefully those people who attended last year, they got so much value from it, and they used all those strategies, they're in their dream job, right? So, all right, so I just wanna make sure, did everybody receive the guidebook? So, no, so Jess, we need a guidebook right up here, please. Couple of guidebooks up here, right here. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to take you through, and you're going to have your own personal guidebook. And you know, the purpose of today's workshop is really to help inform you of current best practices, and also really give you some time. We're going to carve out some time for you to really do some self-reflection and create a customized job search plan as we go through each of the 7 career strategies. So you are going to leave here with your own actions and plans about things that you can do, things that you know you're gonna learn, things that you're probably already doing, you know, that are working for you, and you know what you can do to put these things in place as the formula for you to think about what your next steps are. So everybody has the guidebook? All right, super. And a lot of this information is in your guidebook. Some I'm just going to elaborate on here. So here are the 7 strategies, and I've tied them into our goals for today. So that'll be one of our strategies. And so these are our goals, that by the end of this workshop, that you're going to identify at least 3 personal strengths, that you will create 1 career goal, that you'll be able to list 3 personal values that you can think about that really align and assess for fit for the workplace, whether it's in your current unit, another department, another job in it outside of UC Berkeley. And you will be able to list 10 people in your network. So we're going to talk about the importance, the key factor of building a network and the network that you already have. And understanding the purpose of a resume, we're going to talk about do's and don'ts of current resume best practices. We'll prepare, we'll talk about how you can prepare for 2 types of interviews and learn about 3 top social media sites that you can use for your job search. Okay, and hopefully you're gonna leave inspired and in action on a customized job search plan. I also just want you to know that if you have any questions or comments along the way, please feel free to, you know, raise your hand or shout them out, and we'll schedule time for that and talk about things in action, you know, as we're talking about that strategy. But first, I want to give a pop quiz. So I want to assess your knowledge of some current career job search practices. So first, question. UC Berkeley is the single largest employer in the East Bay. True or false? How many think it's true? All right. How many think it's false? All right. So this is a tough one. It's true. And if you watched the workshop on YouTube from last year, the answer was false. So This year, it's true, Kaiser is number two. Last year, Kaiser was number one. And the emphasis is on East Bay. So if we were looking at Bay Area, Kaiser would be number one. But when we're looking at just the East Bay, it's UC Berkeley right now with close to 24,000 employees. And that includes temporary and students and summer part-time staff. Okay. So next question. So based on a recent survey, employees rate culture highly, listing the work environment as the third most important factor for loving their job. Third most important factor. How many think that's true? How many think it's the number one factor? Yeah, it's okay, well let's see. That was a trick question, I was leading you. But yes, culture is the third, rated as a third. Okay, it's coworkers are actually number one. And they're number one three times greater. That answer was given three times more. It was rated three times higher than the number two answer of freedom and flexibility. So that's the number two rating of what's most important for them in loving their job. And then number three is culture. But they're all really important, and we're gonna talk about all of those things. Okay. Next question, more than 70% of people land jobs by applying through the online, the major job boards online. And so the major job boards are places like Monster, Career Builder, Indeed, okay? How many think that's true? Okay, all right, getting the room, smart group here, false. Yes, so actually more than 70% of people land jobs through networking. 70% of jobs are acquired through networking, not applying online. And as you heard Barinder speak, you know, there's a lot of, you know, just great strategy in talking with people and applying, but we'll talk about how to actively apply. Okay. The best time to network is after a job has been posted, once you've found out about that job. Is that true? How many think that's true? Okay. All right. Wow, you guys are smart. It's false. So the best time to network is actually before a job has been posted. And really, it's important, it's helpful to learn about a job and to network even after a job has been posted, but technically that's not even networking. That's like, you know, wanting to learn about a job. Networking is about really building relationships and taking time to learn about a person that you're speaking with and to learn about their job and, you know, their role. So that's the key of networking. And then usually it's very reciprocal and they want to know about you. And you're learning how you can support one another. So that's networking, and that's a very powerful way about being considered for jobs and learning about them before they're posted. So last question, it's illegal for employers to perform online searches to screen prospective candidates. How many think that's true? Okay. All right, now there might have been some interesting cases where if they looked, if they used passwords, that could be illegal. But as long as you're looking online at public profiles, public information, it's false, okay? And according to a survey commissioned by Microsoft a few years ago, I'm sure the percentage is higher, but 75% of the companies they surveyed had policies actually requiring their companies to do online searches to screen prospective candidates. So, you know, think about, you know, if somebody is searching your name online, what's going to come up? Okay, so we'll also be talking about that. All right, so let's jump into, and this is sort of an overview just to assess your knowledge, and this is a really smart group. And, you know, after all, this is a really lucky group. You have already been successful in a job search. You're all here working at the top public university in the world. So I want you to, you know, just keep that in mind. You guys have, you know, you've done something, you're doing things that have made you successful. And just think about, you know, what else can you continue to do that you do well, and how might these strategies even make you more successful? So the first strategy is about identifying your strengths, okay? And, you know, one of the best ways you know, for people to perceive you, you know, and to see your talents is for you to feel really confident and able to, you know, speak about them and give examples of your strengths. And so we are now, we're moving into our guidebook, and we are on page 3. Okay, so we're in the first strategy, identifying your strengths. And, you know, when I talk with clients, a lot of the times they're like, you know, I really want to make a change. I'm looking for something more meaningful. You know, this job that I'm in, you know, was great, but something's changed and I've changed. And or maybe it's that, you know, 4 or 5 year mark where I'm looking for a challenge. But they're not sure, like, what's next? You know, that's such a common challenge I hear from people. It's like, I'm just not sure, or, you know, I don't know where to start. And this is a really great place to start, is to really think about, okay, what are my strengths? What do you love to do? You know, what do people compliment you on? What are things that you do well? So I want you to think about that, and I'm going to give you time. I'm going to give you 2 minutes to really reflect and list those things down on your guidebook. This is going to be part of your action plan, is just to think about, like, you know, and this can be, you know, at work, what are the things that I do well? What do I love to do? What do people compliment me on? And outside of work. So I want to encourage you, as you go through this guidebook, to go through it and think of your answers to these questions with a mindset of unlimited possibility thinking. There's plenty of time for all of us to be realistic and pragmatic about our decisions, but when you can think outside of the box and come up with some new creative ideas, you might recognize that, wow, you know, I had an aha moment, or I'm not using this skill, or this is what I really love to do. Okay, so within that mindset, I'm gonna give you 2 minutes, and I want you to fill the page. You know, list as many strengths as you can in those areas. So I will time you, and I will give you a 10-second warning when 2 minutes is up. So begin. How many people were able to fill the page? How many people? One person. Wow, all right, way to go. That's great. Way to know your strengths. Now, how many people had a difficult time with this? Yeah. How many people came up with at least 3? Almost everybody? Okay. Any questions or comments? Did you notice that you know, there were some patterns between what you love to do and what people compliment you on or what you do well? Or were there some real distinctions, like, there are things people compliment you on that you don't necessarily like to do? Yeah. Well, let me tell you a funny story. So Jack Canfield, he's a coach and trainer. He's written the Chicken Soup for the Soul books, and I've had some nice opportunities to train with him and be trained by his coach, Marsha Weider, and he tells a story in helping somebody, you know, find their passion and identify their strengths. And he tells a story about this woman that he worked with years ago. It was before the internet was real big, okay? So keep that in mind. It was back in the 70s. And it was a successful woman executive, and she ended up losing her job. And she had a severance package, and she wasn't really enjoying staying at home and recognized she had to, like, go back to work, but just didn't know, you know, what was next for her. She was working with Jack as her coach, and he said, well, you know, what is it that you love to do? And she said, honestly, right now, I just love sitting at home watching soap operas all day long. I mean, I'm just hooked. I love them. I could watch them all day long, but, you know, how could I make a living from that? And so in working with Jack and, you know, being a creative businesswoman that she is, She also recognized there were a lot of other people who loved soap operas and loved to watch them. But again, this was before the internet, okay? You know, they couldn't just do on demand or TiVo or watch it online. She recognized there were so many other people who would love to watch soap operas, but they're working. So she decided to create a weekly magazine. She named it Soap Opera Digest. And it rose to over 1 million circulation, and she and her husband founded Soap Opera Digest. And that was from her thinking like, well, what I really love to do is watch soap operas all day. And she created a booming business from it. That was Angela Shapiro back in the 70s, who then became involved with ABC TV and TLC and Discovery Channel. So her career was launched from that, what she thought was sort of this ridiculous dream. So, you know, think about what you love to do, what your strengths are. She put her strengths into play of, you know, watching that, being able to summarize, write, and market that material in a way that she got to do what she loved. All right. So think about your strengths. Does anybody have any questions or comments? Okay. All right. We will move forward to our next strategy, which is creating career goals. Okay, so now you work at UC Berkeley. There are, you know, lots of goals and initiatives, and you know, how many people have heard of the famous Yale Goals Study? Anybody heard of that? Well, that's good, because it was actually an urban legend. It didn't exist, but years ago, people would say, "Oh, it's really important, you know, to think about and write your goals and share them." Because, you know, there's this Yale study that says if you write out your goals and share them, you'll be successful, but nobody could find the study. And Fast Company revealed it as an urban legend. But there was a professor, Gail Matthews, at Dominican University of California, the other University of California, and she decided that, well, if that study doesn't exist, I'm going to do one. So she did a goal study, and she involved over 300 people from all over the world in this study. I think it was about 150 that actually ended up completing the goals study. And this is what she found out about goals from this sample group, is that if you think about a goal and rate its difficulty, like how difficult is that goal, that was the criteria, that 43% of those people were able to those people were able to achieve 43% of their goals. If a person in that group thought about it, rated it, wrote the goals out, and added action commitments and shared it with someone, they accomplished or achieved 64% of their goals. And then there was a third group that they did all of the above. They thought about it, rated it, wrote it, shared it, wrote action commitments, and then they gave a weekly progress report to a friend. So they talked about where they were with their goals. They achieved 76% of their goals. So that's really powerful. Even just thinking about a goal and rating it, you can achieve almost half of your goals. So there's a lot of power in creating goals for yourself. And it's even more powerful when you can share it, when you write it, and when you're actually holding yourself accountable, or you have an accountability buddy with someone. So I want you to, you know, as you think about your career and what you want for yourself, you know, think about creating a goal. And, you know, it doesn't have to be a giant goal. It might be. You might have a big goal, but even creating the smallest goal. So, you know, what is your goal that you can think of that's, you know, 1 month from now, or 6 months from now, or a year from now, and, you know, 5 years from now, long term. And I want to give you a formula for creating a goal. It's the SMART formula. So SMART, it's in your workbook, and we're on page 4. So the SMART formula for goal setting is that it's specific, measurable, achievable or attainable, relevant or realistic, and time-bound. All right, and so I had fun writing up a goal here as an example for you. And this goal is actually 1/6 and 1 year from now. This goal is sort of all-encompassing as a SMART goal. So here's an example. And take a look at it, and then I just want you to pick a goal for yourself, pick a time frame, and write out that goal on the sheet of paper. There's so much power in writing it. So there is actually even more power when you handwrite. When you take notes and when you handwrite, it actually moves it more deeply into your consciousness. Okay, so I'm gonna give you 2 minutes to write out a goal. If you have completed that, writing that goal, and you have more time, write out another goal. All right, I'll give you the 10-minute warning. Anybody wanna share their goal with the entire room? Share it and declare it, and then you're even that much more closer to achieving it because you're sharing it. Anybody? If you share your goal, you might even find somebody in this room who can support you. Yes?
Okay, so I'll share my 2 1-month goals that I have.
Okay, great,
one would
thanks.
Be to update my resume, and the other one would be to look at the classes we can take around project management to make that
sort of all right. All right, super. Jennifer?
Joanne,
sorry. I can't say that well. So thank you for sharing, Joanne. And Joanne, so with, for example, updating your resume, how can you use the SMART formula? Like, how could you make that time bound for yourself if you were to give yourself a time frame to complete it by?
I think I could do that in a week.
Okay. All right. And so can you give yourself an actual date? So if it's time bound, then you know, like, oh, on this date, like a week for you, is that 5 days? Is that 5 business days? Is that a weekend? So this way, if you are specific with yourself and it's time bound, then you can track, like, did I accomplish this? Okay? And this is for everyone. Thanks for sharing so that we can use this for learning. Okay? And then, how can you even get more specific? Like, what is, for you, and for anyone listening, they could have the same goal, update my resume. What does that mean? What does that look like? Does that mean add your current job experience? Look at, what accomplishments you can add to it, or, how you want to customize it for that dream job. So what specifics can you add to that? Okay, thanks, Joanne. Did somebody else have one they wanted to share? Hi.
Hi, my name's Daniel.
Daniel?
Yes, sir.
Hi, Daniel.
My goal is to enroll in classes and to complete master's program.
Okay.
And I've applied for the first class starting in September.
Uh-huh.
And just started, part of the reason why I'm here is to kind of find things in student services.
Oh, thank you. We have a microphone. Okay, great. Thanks.
So now everybody can hear me stutter a little bit. basically getting my master's, and student services has a new master's program that they're doing to help kind of organizational development and help students.
Wow.
So that's one of my goals.
All right, super. And you mentioned that you applied for September, so there's a time.
So there's a time frame. There's 4 classes at Berkeley Extension, so I've applied for the first one. And
All right.
Started on that goal.
Okay, super. Thanks for sharing. Now, how many people didn't know that there was a master's program or a way to support, you getting your master's if you're an RSSP? Super. Thank you. Anyone else want to share their goal? Okay, well, I want to give everybody a chance to really improve their percentage of accomplishing their goal. So what I would love for you to do is I want you to just grab a partner, somebody who's sitting next to you or behind you, and I'm going to give you each a minute, and I want you to share that goal with one other person. Okay, so I'll give you a minute, and then I'll let you know when a minute is up, and then switch. Okay, so this is really great practicing sharing, and who knows, you might find an accountability partner. So you guys are still sharing, so it sounds like you are, sharing some exciting goals. Like, who heard somebody share a goal, and they're so inspired by it, they wanna share it, what they heard? Anybody wanna share what they heard from someone that really inspired them? Yes. I'm sorry, we need the microphone over there. I don't know if everybody heard that. Okay.
We're just happy that she wants to retire in 5 years.
All right. So there's still time, huh? Yeah. All right. Anything else? Yes. Right here.
My neighbor here Lori. Informed me of something that I didn't
know. Hello. Thank you. I just learned from my neighbor here that the classes that we're allowed to take for free through extension have been reduced from 3 to 1. Aha. Uh-huh. I'm not the only one who didn't know this. So I'm inspired to go to the table downstairs where they have information about which classes are open for our free enrollment and to actually take the time to enroll now that
okay.
It's down to one.
Is it? Because before we had 3, now it's down for the fiscal year.
So you can now enroll in one course at UC Extension per fiscal year rather than 3. So thank you for sharing. See what you learned from sharing goals, and thank you for sharing it. Now everybody knows. And here's a great example of, you know, things that happen with goals. Like sometimes there are things, we have a plan, and sometimes things are, you know, happen that are beyond our control, and how do we adjust? Or, you know, by learning more information, you know, how do we revise our goal in a way that helps us, you know, get what we want or move toward what we want. So, all right, and any others? Yes, here and then here, yes.
So absent the ability to retire within 5 years, Andre is excited to be deeply entrenched in extremely fulfilling work 5 years from now.
Excellent.
Which I find exciting.
All right. Wonderful goal. Okay, and we had one more over here.
We kind of came to the conclusion that sometimes we're the ones that keep us from achieving our goals with our own fears and doubts. So we kind of have to jump that goal first.
Yes, what an important share they all are. Thank you for sharing. And that's such an important point and so common. I mean, in the many clients that I work with, you know, one of the underlying common themes is it's confidence, or, you know, what people are afraid of, you know, afraid of that change or making that move. And so thank you for sharing that. And that is a really important goal. And there are many ways to practice, you know, even just talking about fears is a great way to, you know, help address that. Well, thanks for sharing. Okay. All right. So you just had practice sharing a goal, writing it, sharing it. So when you write it, when you think about it, when you write it, when you speak it, it's very powerful. I encourage you to continue that and find an accountability partner who you can work with. You have many here in this room now who, you know, have the same guidebook and who you can share your strategies with. All right. So our next note, so you've identified your strengths. You know, thinking about those strengths, you're able to create a goal, a career goal. And now the next strategy is to find alignment between your values and the organizational culture. So again, remember in the quiz, you know, culture was rated as the third most important factor to people loving their job. And, you know, coworkers was number one and freedom was number two. Culture is number three. So, you know, what do we mean, you know, by culture and values? And a lot of people, you know, they don't take the step of really assessing for fit. So with culture, it's like, what kind of environment do you thrive in? That's what we mean by culture. And how can you find out about it? You know, where can you learn about that? What do you already know? You know, who can you talk to? What can you read? How do the employees feel about where they work, where it is that you're interested in working? Just take a look at where you work now, and how would you describe the culture? You know, what are the different characteristics of that environment? Is it one that there's, you know, it's a culture of teamwork or collaboration, or, you know, it's one of creativity, or it's one of structure, you know, depending on the work you do. If you're in financial management, you know, or, you know, if you're in event planning, you know, that's two different kinds of activities and behaviors that are needed in terms of strength and the type of people who thrive there. So think about you know, what values are important to you? And values, they range, you know, in terms of, it could be, I want an environment of trust, I want an environment of flexibility, or I want an environment of structure, or I want an environment where I can be a sole contributor, or I want to work in a team, or I want both. So think about, what kind of environment is it that you thrive in? Okay, and then I want you, you know, take that step. You know, think about what you love and where you're a great fit. Once you figure that out, then you know what to look for. You know how to assess. You know how to ask people about their culture and see what aligns for you. So I want you in your guidebook to do the action step at the top. So list your top three values as they translate into the kind of work environment where you thrive. And then jump down to the bottom one with the two blanks, list two specific places to research that could be a good fit with your values and your ideal criteria. And the exercise in the middle about exploring the following questions to get a sense of your ideal job criteria, if you're really stuck with values or figuring out where, you know, the first exercise and the third exercise, this is something for you to do on your own later. It's a real fun activity to just, again, with an unlimited possibility mindset, explore your ideal job criteria. You know, what is it that I'd love to be doing? Who am I working with? You know, where is it? You know, what is my schedule? How much am I making? Why am I doing it? You know, so think about those things, and it can help give you more clues to your values and the kind of culture that you would thrive in. And, you know, once you define it for yourself, again, it's so much easier to see what's out there. And then for you to be able to identify your strengths and your values and be able to speak with enthusiasm and interest about a job that you're interested in, because you've done your own personal work. That's why, you know, these steps are so helpful. It's about, you know, doing the self-reflection work first. So let's take a couple of minutes. I'll give you 2 minutes to do both of those action steps, listing your values and then coming up with two places. And these could be two places, of course, here on campus, you know, another unit or department, or outside of campus. All right, so please start, and I'll give you the 10-second warning. We have now identified our strengths, created career goals, and looked at how we can align our values with cultural fit for alignment. And how many people were able to complete that last activity? Okay, anybody have any questions about values, or anyone have a, you know, any problem trying to identify two places that are fit for their values? Okay. Okay. What an excellent segue. So here, if you don't know, if you couldn't fill in the blanks of two places, you know, here's the next step. Here's how you can find out, by building and really leveraging your existing network. Okay? So this, I can't emphasize this enough, and I'm sure you heard this, you know, you heard this with our morning keynote speaker, and you'll hear it with many workshops. I believe, you know, there's actually a workshop today on networking, and networking is so powerful. As I mentioned earlier in the quiz, you know, about 70% of jobs are found through one's network, and 80% of available jobs are never advertised, according to an article in Forbes magazine. That's not the case here at UC Berkeley, fortunately. You know, there are many organizations that are required by law to advertise positions, but there are many small and medium-sized private companies and that don't have to advertise. Or there are people that create jobs, or a job might, you know, be recrafted. So there are even ways, you know, that certain jobs are not advertised, and it's so powerful when you are networking and you hear about those jobs before they are advertised for those that are. And it's also, networking is a great way for you to be able to now practice, you know, sharing about your strengths and goals and assessing for organizational fit. Now that you know what kind of organizations are, if you're looking, you know, you can share, you know, the kinds of organizations that you thrive in and ask your network, like, where, you know, who do they know, or, you know, what companies are fit for you? So in networking, though, networking, really another name for networking is about building relationships. Some people hear the word networking and it's just like, oh God, networking. I gotta go to a meeting and meet people I don't know. Will I really ever speak to them again? So I want you to reframe it for yourself. Really, networking is just about building relationships with people that you're interested in talking with and getting to know. So that's what networking is. And you already have a very powerful network. And I mean, I see my clients, clients who are struggling in their job search. When they actually start using activities around building their network or just connecting with people that they're interested in talking with and going out and meeting people that they're interested in talking with, the opportunities flood in. Here's one example of a client that I worked with recently who all of a sudden, you know, she contacted me because she was going to interviews and just like not getting the job offer or not feeling like it was even the right fit. She started really reaching out to her network and people were referring her to opportunities. She was in a reception room for an interview, and there was another candidate there in the reception room. They were both there for interviews. Luckily, there were multiple positions there, so it wasn't like they were competing for the same job, but they started talking about, you know, what they were interviewing for, and the person sitting in the reception room with my client, they hit it off, and the person said, oh my God, you would be perfect for this job at my current company, and so ended up referring her to a job where this other person worked, and my client was so excited, it was like even a better fit. So you never know where you're going to meet people when you just have conversations and talk about shared interests. And so she actually ended up getting a job lead from another person who was interviewing for a similar position while she was waiting in the reception room. So that's just one story of the power of networking or being curious or just creating connections and being able to share in a clear and enthusiastic manner, you know, what you're interested in. So we're on page 6, and I want you to take some time to really think about who is in your network. And so start with your family and friends. Like, okay, who is in your family? And even if you have a small family, it's not just about your family, but it's about like who in your family, who do they know? So it's the power of, you know, their knowledge and their connections that can be so helpful. And, you know, there might even be a lot of times where you're not used to talking with your family or maybe even some of your friends about work, or maybe for some people that's all they hear about is work and, you know, how awful it is. So here's a different, you know, a shift is to talk about them, you know, talk about yourself, about your dream job and who do they know. So it's a way to shift it. So, you know, when you're talking with your family, you know, ask them who they know with your friends and also with colleagues. And think about, you know, what these categories mean to you. They could be broader categories. You know, friends, colleagues might mean, you know, people in your book club or people you volunteer with or people you meet at trainings and conferences and professional development meetings where you volunteer. So if you can start thinking about, like, who do I know? And start out with like, all right, who do I know who it's like, it's really easy to talk to, and start listing them in these categories of your family, friends, colleagues. And then start thinking about like, all right, who would I like to talk to? Maybe I haven't talked to them in a while. Who would I really like to talk to? Who would I love to meet? You know, so I want you to spend, again, 2 minutes, taking some time to list for yourself who is in your network. This can be so powerful because after you take this step, then you're gonna, you know, take the step to reach out to them. So 2 minutes, and see if you can fill up this entire page. And at the very least, try to list 3 people in each category. So it's good to be diverse in your connections and who you know. All right, I'll give you 2 minutes. I'll give you the 10 second warning. Okay, how many got at least 3 in each category? Anybody not get 3 in each category? Okay, all right. So if you feel like you can't get it, you know, get 3 in one category, you know, how can you build in another category? Or is that, wow, what does that say? Is it, how can you, you know, take a look at, wow, how do I reconnect with my family or my friends? Okay. So, all right, we build our network, and a lot of times when you're connecting with your network, you know, one of the things they're going to say, oh, do you have a resume? Send me your resume. So we're going to really understand the purpose of a resume. And it's, you know, the purpose of a resume is not to get the job, okay? It's to get you the interview, okay? Really, I want to be clear. The purpose of a resume is to get you the interview. Your main goal is to get the job. But if you can, you know, just think about, okay, Wimbledon's going on right now, right? And so, you know, Venus Williams is out there and, you know, the purpose of her hitting that ball at that moment, you know, is to get it over the net, not to win Wimbledon. So it's like, it's really being focused and taking small steps. So that's what I mean about just understanding the focus of the resume is to get you an interview. And when you focus in and you recognize, okay, how can this resume get me the interview is, you know, is that you're customizing it for that particular job. That's how the resume gets you the interview, which can, the interview then leads to the job. So that's why I want to emphasize that the purpose of a resume is actually to, you know, help get you the interview too, because there are many things that you're going to do along the way to get the interview. It's using your network, you know, it's your communications, and it's also the resume. So let's focus on the resume. And again, we are on page 7 of your guidebook. And so there are some current best practices for resume creation. And here are 5 common mistakes, just in terms of best practices. And, you know, and sometimes these fluctuate. So several years ago, you know, what is a mistake considered not a best practice today is the objective statement at the top. Many years ago, like, that was required. Put your objective of this job and, you know, have that at the top. Right now, that's not a current best practice. And, you know, as I'm sharing these things, I want you to know that there's no one formula that is just the right way. But this, in my experience, is what is the current best practice and what, based on current research, recruiters, or people looking at resumes, you know, this is the current trend and desire. So use of fancy fonts and styling to stand out from the pile, currently not a best practice. Now with applicant tracking systems, you know, that can really get your resume thrown out. So you want to keep it simple, clear, concise, and use simple formatting. Resume, a mistake is to include every job you've ever had on the resume. Not needed. So the resume is to show your current relevant accomplishments and experiences for a job. And typically, you know, the most recent 10 years is fine. If there's something beyond 10 that's relevant, then you could include it. The exception is, and especially in academic research, is a CV on the academic side. Then it's required to have all of your research and publications listed on your CV. That's never been a best practice step. Typo, so it's kind of a mistake. And, you know, it happens. Just have somebody else proof your work, look at it. Another good way, if you're proofing it yourself, print it out and read it upside down. That's a good way to look at it with fresh eyes. And you can see mistakes or formatting or spacing errors. Okay, and then includes references available upon request. No longer a best practice. It's just, you know, it's assumed that you have references and they'll ask you for them. Or a lot of times when you're applying online, you put that in a different section. Okay, and so in thinking about how to update your resume, you want it targeted for a specific position. Okay, you want it clean, simple, organized layout. You know, nice margins. You could use Times New Roman or Arial font. Those are good simple fonts that are easily read by the human eye as well as applicant tracking systems. And that, you know, once you've updated your resume, and even though it's targeted for a specific job, that you incorporate that information into your LinkedIn profile, because a lot of people are screening online and will be looking at your LinkedIn profile. Yes, you had a question?
So instead of the objective at the top, I've seen some practices of a summary of qualifications or a summary of achievements that's two or three bullet points. Have you seen that in the field these days, and is that a best practice as well?
Great question. That is different than an objective statement that says, you know, I'm interested in the senior analyst position at this department. That can go in the cover letter. But a summary of qualifications is totally acceptable and is a good best practice. So, great question for making the distinction. And a summary of qualifications is also customized for the job that you're applying for. You want to look at the job description. You want to see what they're looking for. And you want to customize that summary so that you're sharing, you know, on a high level, you know, how you fit what they're looking for. And then you go into more detail through accomplishment-focused bullets on the resume. Okay? Yes.
This is going to depend on the amount of relevant experiences you've had, but keeping your resume to one page, is that still a best practice, or is it okay to go into two pages, three pages? I've been told that one page is where you should be keeping it.
One page is ideal and impressive, too, if you can do that and really communicate clearly your accomplishments. But 1 to 2 pages is acceptable as long as it's needed. So 1 to 2 pages is fine. You know, somewhere at Berkeley, I think 1 to 2 pages is very acceptable. You could check with the Berkeley staff as to what they think about that. And anybody is here from recruitment that wants to weigh in on that. But because some organizations want to see, you know, committees you're on, or even, you know, one of the, you know, the culture fit and, you know, part of the mission is service. So it's really helpful for UC Berkeley resumes to show your community service. It shows how you're involved in the community. So that, you know, that kind of information isn't necessarily, you know, required or even relevant on a resume, you know, applying for a bank. But here at UC Berkeley, yes. So it would require more space, more information. Okay, so depending on what you're putting in there, 1 to 2 pages is acceptable these days in general. Okay, yes.
I've also seen in looking at resumes we've received, the skills section, and people write down like every computer application they know, and I was just wondering if it's something very specific to the job or unusual, or are you supposed to put like, people say they know how to use email. I mean, what?
So it depends on the job. If it's a highly technical job, like something in IT, and the job description is listing all these technical skills, then you might have a separate skills section as keep it relevant to the job you're applying for. However, in general, when a job description lists some skills, you can incorporate that into your summary of qualifications. Use 1 or 2 bullets to communicate the skills that you have that are relevant to that job instead of a skills section and a whole list. You can also include a link to your LinkedIn profile, which can be much more comprehensive than a resume that lists many skills. And so just put that at the header, and you can mention in your cover letter that they can refer to your LinkedIn profile for even more information. Okay, I know we are getting towards the end of our time here. We have 10 minutes, so I'm gonna move on, and if there are any other questions about that, we'll have time at the end, or you can see me after. Okay, so you've created your excellent resume, and now you are ready for interviews. Okay, that's not working. Let's see. It's not working. Okay, well, you have it in your guidebook, and we will move forward. We are on page 8 in preparing for interviews. So there are 2 types of interviews. There's the job interview, and there are informational interviews. And for purposes of our discussion and time, I'm gonna focus on mainly the informational interviews. And because a lot of times an informational interview leads to the job interview. And informational interviews are great practice before you have a formal interview. And really, please understand the purpose of an informational interview. It's not to get you a job or to apply for a job or ask for a job. It's to learn about that company and organization or unit and the kinds of opportunities that are coming up. But it's not a job interview. Thank you, whoever fixed that. Thank you so much. The purpose of the informational interview is really for you to connect with that person and build relationships. And a lot of people, you know, they ask for an informational interview. And people who, when you contact somebody for an informational interview, they typically know, they understand that you're interested for career reasons. But when you go to the informational interview, the way to really use that time effectively is for you to focus on the person that you're meeting with. That's really the key, is to come prepared with a list of questions and, you know, for you just basically to ask them questions about themselves, professional questions, like, so can you tell me about your role? And, you know, how did you get, you know, come to be here in this role? And what was the hiring process like for you? You can learn so much just by asking someone about their experience. So that's the difference. It's not a job interview. It's actually a way for you to build a relationship, connect, and learn about their path. And find out about their role, some of the industry trends, and what it took for them. And then, very naturally, that person is then going to ask about you. You know, so tell me about you, and you know, what are you interested in? When that happens, then you're prepared. And you have prepared your answers, where you know how to share about yourself, your strengths, your values, your goals, and it's a conversation. So that is the informational interview. You're learning about a particular job, you're building your networks, and you're gaining interview experience. The best way to set up informational interviews, really the best way, is to start with your network. You know, the names on page 6 that you spent some time listing. That's really the best way. You know, who were the people that came to mind? Who can you go to and ask? And then, you know, ask them who they know. Like, if it's not necessarily somebody on that list, it's like, who can they introduce you to? So ask them, okay? And then you want to prepare questions and really make sure that you follow up. And by follow up, it's, you know, includes a thank you note, but it includes staying in touch. So an informational interview, you know, is not necessarily a one-time event with this person. It's like you're reaching out to them and you want to build that relationship. And you also want to find out, like, you know, as you're learning about them, how can you be of service to them? What can you do for them? How can you help them? Can you share an interesting article? Are they also, you know, looking to make a career change? Is there an interesting training, you know, based on what they shared that you can share with them? So how can you be of service to them? Okay, so supporting others. And then the job interviews, you know, when you're ready for the job interview, it's about practicing. The informational interviews are gonna help you practice speaking to people, sharing about yourself. And then you wanna do your research and know the company. You wanna know the role, the job. And when you are going to an interview, there are some other tips here about building rapport. There's a great method for answering behavioral-based interview questions, the SOAR method. So you can check out the resources here in the guide. There are links at the bottom and in the back that'll help you with that. So I want you to take 30 seconds. I want you to think about page 6, and I want you to list 2 people that you can schedule an informational interview with. And then see if you can take those names and turn it into a SMART goal. I will contact this person to talk with them about this by this date. Make it a goal. All right, so our 7th and final career strategy is for your overall job search. You've got all these in place. You're doing your informational interviews. I want you to also keep in mind how you can leverage the internet for your job search. And as you're planning your next move with your career. And how many people have heard of the 60-30-10 rule? Okay, so this is so helpful. if you can just, when you are spending your time on your job search, keep in mind this formula, 60-30-10. Okay, so it's a formula for how you're using your time in your job search, you know, doing all these different activities. So this is a winning formula, and it, you know, should look something close to this, is that 60% of your time that you're spending on your job search is spent in face-to-face interactions with people. So that's going on informational interviews or job interviews, going to networking meetings or having lunch or coffee with a colleague or a friend or family member who's in your network, volunteering, going to professional association meetings, conferences, all that. Anytime you are face-to-face with a person having a conversation that includes something about your career goal, you give yourself credit. That's the face-to-face time. 30% of your time with your job search is electronic. And so that's networking, but not face-to-face. So that could be spending time connecting with people on LinkedIn or on Facebook or on Twitter, doing some research about jobs, finding out what meetings exist. So all the things, all the electronic things that you do. And then 10% of your time for your job search is ideally is spent on preparing your professional documents, resume, cover letter, a thank you note. Now there's, in today's day and age, there's even some overlap in these three categories. So electronic, you might have a Skype meeting with somebody, which could be an informational interview, or you might be on the phone. So, but if you use this formula and look at how you're spending your time, most people actually spend most of their time on the electronic and writing. It's usually about 80 to 90% of the time doing non-face-to-face activities, and maybe 10 to 20% of their time doing face-to-face. So if you were just to, say you took 5 hours a week spending it on a job search to move into your next dream job, 5 hours. So if you were to, 60% of 5 hours would be what, 3 hours, right? 3 hours, did I do the math right? Okay, and then 30% would be 1.5, and 10% would be a half an hour. So think about where you're spending your time. Most people spend hours working on their resume or hours looking on job boards. So if you just keep that one rule in mind and track your time and think about, okay, my 5 hours, how am I spending my 3 of my 5 hours this week? How can I schedule 3 lunches? How can I schedule 3 or 4 coffees? And then you would be surprised at how fast your job search process is going to move, where you're gonna learn about more opportunities. So that's one way just to keep in mind. I know we're talking about the internet, but keep that rule in mind when you are spending time on the internet. I don't want you to just get lost on the internet and think that's where all your time should be. Track it. Then when you are spending time on the internet, these are the 3 top social media sites for your job search. There are other sites that are ranked higher in terms of people using them, but in terms of job search and networking, these are the top sites. So LinkedIn in the US has 115 million users. These are adult users, and of all the people that use the internet in the US who are adults, 28% of people are on LinkedIn. While it might seem smaller in numbers compared to Facebook, the difference is that LinkedIn is focused on professional networking. So it's focused. Facebook, you could be talking about anything, you know, that you took your dog for a walk. But in LinkedIn, and we're talking about business and work and opportunities. So that's why it's the number one professional networking site for you to be engaged with. How, is there anybody here that's not on LinkedIn? Just a couple of people. So I would encourage you to just start exploring before you need it and start connecting. It's great that most of you are on LinkedIn. So, great site to start meeting people, join discussion groups, update information onto your profile. Anybody here who's on LinkedIn does not have a photo? So it's really important to have a photo. You get 13 times more the viewership. Or if you're trying to connect, if there's not a photo, somebody's like, who is this? Or they don't pay attention. So it's great that most of you have a photo. Facebook, this is the way to use your social network, your friends and family, or your friends of friends for your networking. And I know many people who've, you know, gotten jobs through Facebook, where they put it out there, or people informally talk about the jobs that are not advertised that need to be filled. And then Twitter. Twitter is just a great way to research companies and look at different professional blogs. So leverage the internet, and while you're doing that, take a look at your presence online. So as mentioned previously and a couple times, most companies are now searching online to screen prospective candidates. How many people have searched their own name online to see what comes up? So maybe half? Well, that's good. It used to be that only like 7% of the people had searched. So it's people are becoming more aware. Search and see what comes up. And you know, if all of your, you know, social activities from Facebook are coming up, maybe you need to check your privacy settings or be mindful too of your image and how you're being represented online. Okay, so that is the seventh and last strategy. And the action step, I don't want you to do it now, but do it later, is to put your own name in Google or Bing or both and see what comes up. Okay, and then I just have for you on page 10 a review. So I would love for you to do this review within 24 hours of now. So this is just, it's a technique that I use with people, and a coach has taught me, is that when you review information within 24 hours, it moves from short-term into long-term memory. Sometimes with my memory, I need to review 24 hours and then 48 hours. I need to keep reviewing. But keep reviewing your guidebook and review all of this information, and then do this review wheel. So this lists all of the seven strategies, actually. One strategy is broken down into two. So there are eight categories for you to rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 as to, you know, your satisfaction with how you're doing with these strategies. And then from there, I want you to, this is 24 hours from now, prioritize and list your top three next steps from this guidebook, from all the action steps you created. What are your top three next steps, and how do you create SMART goals for them? Okay, any questions? Okay. All right. There are also a list of additional resources on the last page, and on each page is a specific resource to help you, to give you more information about that specific strategy. Please feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. I would love to stay in touch, and I'd love to hear how things are going. If you have any questions or how you're doing with your career strategies to land your next dream job. So it's been a pleasure. Thanks for your attention. Thanks for your interaction. And I wish you the best of success. And go Bears.